Afternoon. Welcome to Bringing the Art of Close Looking to the Classroom. We are really excited that you are all joining us this afternoon. In this session, we'll discuss how works of art and museum objects can be used across the curriculum to engage students in critical thinking and broaden the stories the teachers tell in the classroom. My name is Briana White, and I am the head of education for the National Portrait Gallery. The National Portrait Gallery's mission is to tell the story of this country through the people who've shaped it. And I am joined by some really wonderful colleagues who will introduce themselves in turn. Phoebe.
Hello, everyone. My name is Phoebe Hillemann. I'm the Teacher Institute's educator at the Smithsonian American Art Museum, and I I'm thrilled to be with you all today. The Smithsonian American Art Museum explores the American experience through the lens of its art and artists for over three centuries. So I'll turn it over to Yolanda to introduce herself next.
Hello, everyone. My name is Yolanda Toni. I am a teacher at Fairview South School in Skokie, Illinois. It's a suburb right outside of Chicago. I have taught my school's gifted advanced English language arts program for grades 3 through 8 for the past 23 years. I really look forward to speaking to you today about my experiences with the Smithsonian.
And my name's Alison Leithner. I am an instructional designer with Smithsonian Enterprises. My background is in helping experts bring their expertise into learning experiences, particularly in the online space. And I also would like to make mention that our colleague, Irina Rubenstein, is in the chat today helping facilitate.
Great, thank you. So just to go over our agenda really quickly, we have, let's be honest, a really packed 45 minutes ahead of us. Phoebe's gonna kick us off in just a moment by discussing the benefits of engaging with objects. Then Phoebe and I will model a close looking strategy with two artworks, one from each of our museum's respective collections. And then we'll turn things over to Yolanda so she can share all the wonderful ways that she's used museum resources with her students. And then finally, last but not least, Alison will round out our session by previewing two free online courses for teachers that highlight Smithsonian objects. And of course, our hope is that we'll have a few minutes at the end of our session to answer some questions that you all might have about what we covered in this session.
Great, so I think we can go to the next slide. And before we actually dive in and model a close looking experience with some artwork with you, we wanted to just touch briefly on why is it something worth doing for you in your classroom, especially if you're not an art teacher, if you teach history or English or science, why might you consider making art and museum objects a practice in your classroom? So these are just a few of the reasons that we have thought of and hope to touch on during this session. So just to go through this briefly, a big one is inspiring curiosity. Artworks tend to be naturally engaging, interesting objects that open up points of interest and engagement for students and get them excited to learn more. So this can be a great way to start a unit and get students engaged and invested. Next, making thematic connections. So looking at artwork does not have to be a completely separate experience from the content you're teaching in your classroom. I guarantee that pretty much anything you teach, the Smithsonian has something that connects with it thematically in some way. So it's a great way to actually enhance your teaching of content and connect thematically. Engaging with multiple perspectives, we do this through bringing in artwork and subject matter that brings in diverse perspectives into your classroom, but it can also be a way to bring out multiple perspectives in your classroom through student discussion. And we'll talk about that more with centering student voice. A big one is building critical thinking skills, such as evidence-based reasoning. So, you know, when you get to that point where you have to justify to an administrator why you're using artwork in a history classroom, it's important to remember that the practices that we're going to be using and modeling for you, you know, doing a close look with an artwork and engaging in inquiry, are the skills that you want to practice for all of your classes, really, and get students comfortable with. And then finally, centering student voice. So these routines and strategies that we use with artwork and museum objects really allow the teacher to sort of step back from the sage on the stage role and become more of a facilitator and make room for students to share their perspectives. And Yolanda's section of the session will give some great examples of how she centered her students' voices. All right, can we go to the, actually, yes, that's perfect, thank you. So in just a moment, I'm going to invite you to start engaging with this object. And we're going to be using a thinking routine called See, Wonder, Connect, which comes from Harvard Graduate School of Education's Project Zero. And if you're not familiar with Project Zero, I definitely encourage you to look into all of the thinking routines that they offer, because they're wonderful inquiry-based strategies that are really easy to implement across the curriculum. It's important to know before we dive in that we are doing a pretty condensed version of a thinking routine because of the time limitations we have, but I really encourage you in the classroom to slow down and take your time with these kinds of looking experiences. So before I invite you to share anything in the chat or start talking for our panelists, I'd like to start by just inviting you to take a close, slow look at the artwork on the screen in front of you. And sometimes I like to encourage you to imagine that your eyes are a scanner and really just cover the whole object with your eyes, really noticing each part of it from top to bottom, left to right. And the first question in the thinking routine, See, Wonder, Connect, is just, what do you see? And what I mean by that is really literally, what can you point to in the artwork? So if you are participating, I'd love for all participants to share some things that they're seeing in the chat. And in the meantime, while those are coming in, I would love to just turn it over to Briana and Alison and Yolanda, feel free to jump in. What are you noticing looking at this piece?
So I'm noticing a big brown square and some brown up at the top, a thinner line of brown up at the top.
Okay, great.
And I'm struck by the sort of earthen tones that we see, right? Sort of, again, the brown that Alison mentioned, but also some kind of maroons and burgundies. They just feel very earth tone to me.
And then I'm really drawn by, with that, you know, the earth tones, and then you have that bright blue diagonal with the white stars that just grabs my attention.
Yeah, absolutely. So we've got these different colors that are really standing out. You notice the symbols, Yolanda, the stars. Is there anything else you're noticing? Or any is there anything coming through in the chat, Arena? Feel free to jump in.
Yeah, there are many observations coming through in the chat. A lot of people are noticing the colors, whether it's the red and white stripes or the red and browns, particularly in the squares, the red, white, and blue of the American flag. And yeah, the shapes and colors are the main observations in the chat.
Great, thank you. Yeah, so we're making some associations with familiar objects and symbols, thinking about the American flag, noticing shapes and colors and textures. And this is a pretty abstract piece, although, you know, there is some familiar imagery. So this is a little bit of a, you know, a challenging one to jump right into. I'm curious, what does this piece make you wonder? And feel free to put your wonderings in the chat, but also panelists, I'm curious what you're wondering.
I'm wondering why, I guess it looks like it's the American flag, but I'm wondering why it's covered the way that it is. So we only see a little bit of the stripes and this like diagonal of the stars.
Right, it's certainly not the traditional flag that we are used to seeing. There's some interesting layering that's happening. And wondering why the artist made the choices that they did here.
Right, and just to add on to that, Phoebe, I am wondering how many layers there are, because I mean, there are ones that we can see with our eyes, but I can only imagine that there are others perhaps that we can't see.
Yeah, absolutely. Irina, are there any good wonderings in the chat that you'd like to share?
There are a lot of good wonderings. What is it made of? Is it a painting or is it quilted? So the material, what does the artist think of America? Another wondering about what the time period is. Is it the Old West? Why is the flag sideways? The symbolism of the earth tones.
Awesome. These are such great questions, and we're getting into, you know, historical context, meaning and symbolism around color choice, materials. So these are all really interesting things to dig into, and we are going to come back to that and share a little bit more information. But before we do that, we're going to share a second artwork to juxtapose with this one, and Briana is going to lead us through a close look of this artwork.
Great, thank you, Phoebe. As Phoebe said, in just a few moments, we will start thinking about these two pieces together. But for our purposes now, focus in on the work on the right-hand side of the slide. And as Phoebe suggested before, let your eyes wander over this piece from top to bottom, side to side, all around. Take in the various details that you can. Think about the setting of this portrait, the clothing that the subject is wearing, any objects that we might see. And when you're ready, share your initial observations that you have about this work. But at the same time, when Phoebe just took us through a sea wonder, we did it as two separate questions. But for the purposes of this particular piece, go ahead and note your initial observations and then perhaps any wonderings that you have about that observation that you made. And I will ask those same questions to my colleagues.
So I can start. So I see the American flag again, but it's being worn this time and it looks like it's upside down and rolled up. And so I wonder what that means, because I know that there are a lot of rules about how flags are supposed to be displayed.
Excellent, excellent. Right. So immediately our eye wanders to the American flag first, and yet it does become a wonder of why it is upside down and what purpose that might serve, not only for the artist, but also the subject as well. Okay. What other observations do we have? And Irina, please feel free to jump in if you're seeing things coming through in the chat.
Yeah, there are other people in the chat noticing the American flag and how it's being worn, and also the symbolism of the American flag.
I'm noticing too, sort of our position looking at this figure, and it seems like the artist has painted him so that we're sort of below him, and he's really this tall figure kind of looking down over us, or at least that's how I perceive it. So it makes me wonder why the artist made that choice, and was that meant to convey something about this person's power? So that's what I'm thinking.
Right. The idea of perspective here is really important. And this work of art is a little more than 6 feet tall, and, you know, a little more than 3 feet wide. And so you can imagine if you're in a gallery setting and you're looking at it, it is, of course, installed, you know, not at floor height. So that perspective that we see in this environment is the same sort of perspective that we would see in the gallery setting. So thank you, Phoebe. Irina, anything else that we might have missed in the chat?
Yeah, there are some people noticing the man's pose in the portrait. So the fact that his hand seems to be clenched, and also people noticing again how he's wearing the American flag, connecting it to maybe someone wearing a Roman toga, or the proper way, in quotes, of wearing this flag and how it should be displayed.
Okay, excellent. And I promise we'll get to the why of the American flag in just a moment. So I think what we'll do is Phoebe and I would like to provide a little bit of context around these images. And next slide. And you can see on the screen the tombstone information for both of these artworks, again, in our respective collections. But what we'd like to do now is invite you all to start sharing your the connections that you might be making between these two images. And perhaps these connections are visual connections. Perhaps if you already know information about these works, you can make connections in that way. But while the audience is responding to that connection question, Phoebe and I are just gonna talk a little bit about these works to provide a little bit of context to take us into our next step. So I will kick us off. This portrait of Russell Means by Bob Coronado was created in 2009 and came into the Portrait Gallery's collection in 2017. Born on the Pine Ridge Reservation in South Dakota, Russell Means was Oglala Lakota Sioux. In 1968, he joined the American Indian Movement, shorthand is AIM. It was an American Indian advocacy group that was organized to address issues related to sovereignty, leadership, and treaties. But particularly in its early years, AIM also protested racism and civil rights violations against Native Americans. And so while Russell Means was not a founder of AIM, he was very much involved in the organization. And when AIM occupied Wounded Knee, which was the site of the infamous 19th century massacre of the Sioux in 1973, Means was the organization's spokesperson. Now, the siege grew into a 71-day confrontation between armed AIM members and federal authorities. And so one of the pieces when Bob Coronado approached Russell Means was that he really wanted to honor Means and the work that he had done throughout his life. And so Means agreed to sit for him as long as the portrait, and these are Russell Means' words, as long as the portrait conveyed that Indians are not the idea of old Hollywood Westerns, or to be thought of as in the past, but a people very much of today and with a rich history. And so when Means was sitting for this portrait, both the artist and Means decided to include this upside down flag, which is a symbol that is used by the Navy as a sign of distress, but is also a symbol that AIM used often, that they displayed during protests. And one of the places that they did display it was during that occupation of Wounded Knee in 1973. So consider all of that context and how it fits in to the American Art Museum's work that Phoebe's going to talk about.
Yeah, so the first piece we looked at, as you can see below the work, this is a piece by Marie Watt called Edson's Flag that was made in 2004. You can see that it's made out of a real American flag from a US military burial with wool blankets, satin, and thread. So Marie Watt's work often includes these blankets, and she talks about how blankets are such a tactile object for her that are connected with memory. And you know, I think when we all think about you know, associations that we have with blankets, they're often connected to warmth and comfort and home and family. And maybe you have a specific memory of a blanket. So she's thinking about all the associations that we're carrying with us. This particular piece was made to honor her great uncle, Edson Plummer, who served in the US Air Force during World War II as an airplane mechanic. This American flag was from his military burial and was actually passed down through Marie Watt's family for several generations until it ended up with her. And she created this piece to honor him. It's also important to note that Watt is an enrolled member of the Seneca Nation. So thinking about traditional associations and contemporary associations with Native American cultures and blankets, you know, often a symbol of, or blankets are often given as gifts to honor somebody or mark an occasion. So there's a layer there with her cultural background and tribal affiliation. So that's just a little bit of context. And I'm curious if anybody in the chat, Irina, has made any interesting connections between these two works, because I think there's a lot to explore there.
Yeah, Phoebe, there are some interesting connections in the chat, specifically around what it means to be American, mm-hmm. And the symbolism again of the American flag.
Yeah, absolutely. Such a rich symbol with so much weight and can be interpreted in different ways depending on your perspective and relationship to the flag. Briana, any thoughts to add to that, or any of the other panelists, any thoughts about connections that are occurring to you?
I don't know. I was just thinking about, you know, the variety of ways of which we honor the flag, right? And we honor this country. And it doesn't necessarily have to be in one particular way. And I think that we're seeing that here, right? With both of these pieces next to each other.
Definitely. And also how we honor a person, right? Thinking about Marie Watt creating this piece for her great uncle, and Bob Coronado making this piece to recognize Russell Means. It's an interesting connection as well.
Yeah. The other connection that I think about is about the ways for of fighting for your land and your country. And the different kinds of service you can give, because we heard from their background that they had different ways of fighting for their nation.
Great. So this is just a tiny taste of a close looking experience, and I feel guilty for cutting it off. But we want to make sure that we have time to hear from Yolanda, who has actually been in the classroom and can speak to, you know, how do you build on an experience like this with your students, and what value does that have for them? So I'm going to turn it over to Yolanda.
Hello, everyone. So I have been very fortunate to participate in numerous opportunities with the Smithsonian. I participated in 3 summer in-person institutes at the Smithsonian American Art Museum. This past year, I participated in SAM's monthly Artful Teaching Moments, which was when teachers could gather once a month on a virtual session to discuss various topics with artifacts. It was a great support for many of us who struggled with remote learning during the pandemic. And I also participated in 2 virtual Smithsonian summer sessions. The last one was this past summer, and it's where I actually connected with this piece that Briana just spoke about Russell Means. And I created, if you go to the next slide, please. I created this learning lab collection entitled Native Americans Breaking the Barriers to Their Own Stories of America, because I was looking for a background front-loading activity to teach the book Killers of the Flower Moon. I read this with my 8th grade students. I'll get back to this later. And the portrait of Russell Means, I found it to be an anchor piece for this learning lab. Because as Briana was explaining, Russell Means wanted his portrait to convey that Indians are not the idea of the old Hollywood Westerns or to be thought of as in the past, but a people very much of today and with a rich history. So pieces selected for this lab connect this feeling and ideas that are also in Killers of the Flower Moon. So some of you who are not familiar with the book, it's the nonfiction story which details members of the Osage Nation in Oklahoma and the mysterious murders that were happening in the 1920s. And many of these individuals likewise are part of a modern society with a rich, complex history. So I've pulled together these resources from the National Portrait Gallery, the Smithsonian American Art Museum, the National Museum of American History, the National Museum of the American Indian, and the National Postal Museum. And many of these resources are artworks, artifacts, videos, articles, postage stamps, all that have like rich information that students could really dive into. And I combine this with the thinking routines, See, Wonder, Connect, which was just discussed, and Unveiling Stories. So if you go on to the next slide, I can show how I did this in my classroom. So I use the thinking routine, See, Wonder, Connect. And in my classroom, I use Jamboard. So for some of you who are not familiar with Jamboard, it's a Google tool that allows students to digitally share in real time their thoughts on a digital board. And some people may be familiar with Padlet. I tend to use that for more asynchronous activities. I really like Jamboard because it has a quick reload time, so students' responses show pretty instantaneously. I also set a few ground rules when I use the Jamboard. I make sure that students, before they post anything on the Jamboard, they have to raise their hand. I have to call on them. They have to share their comment, and only then can they post their comment on the Jamboard, because if you just leave it open, you'll have 20 responses of students racing to put their ideas, and you just have 20 posts of the same thing. So this way, students can really interact with each other, they listen to each other, and it really leads more into more thoughtful discussion. So as was explained just previously, I had the Russell Means portrait up on my smart board, and then my students have their Chromebooks and I have my computer, and we have the Jamboard up on that. And I call on students. So I ask them to do a deep look at the portrait, let their eyes touch every part of the portrait. And then I ask them to share what they see. And some of them make comments as, yes, they see that he has a watch. They see that he has a necklace. They see that he has a flag wrapped around him. And after we go through that process of see, then we move on to wonder. What do you wonder about this portrait? And it takes time. I'm going through this rather quickly, but as you will see that they had lots of things that they were wondering about, like why is the flag upside down? They had noticed on the see that he's not smiling, so why does he have a look of disappointment? So we go through the see, wonder, and then I give a little background on Russell Means and about his life, as Brianna had explained, as an activist for Native American rights. And then I go on to the connect. And so what I did in my learning lab I broke my students up into four groups, and I actually found different individuals who I wanted to do a comparison with. So I found, from the top, I have Sitka Lessa, who was a Native American activist, Mary Golda Ross, who is a well-known aerospace engineer, who is part Cherokee, Jim Thorpe, who is a world-renowned athlete, and the world-renowned ballerina Maria Tallchief, who was Osage. In the book. So, and she is mentioned in the book as well. So I had students make these connections as they're looking and they're talking in their groups and they're seeing things. So like at the top, you can see on the post-its, they're making connections with Zika Lessa and Russell Means, seeing that they're both having necklaces. They both have similar expressions and allows them to do a deep comparison of the figures. And as they go through this, it's really interesting hearing their talk in groups. And then we pull it together at the end of class and students are sharing, each group shares what they discovered about these individuals as they did the comparison between the two. And the observations just showed a lot of depth and these connections and sparked a lot of interest about knowing more about these people. So this lent itself to the next day, if you want to go to the next slide. We used this activity and went on to the thinking routine, unveiling stories. So since students got a taste of a little bit more background about the individuals in the first activity, in unveiling stories, they're allowed to go into more research. So each student gets to choose one of the individuals that they found engaging to them. So there were five questions in unveiling stories in this thinking routine that makes students really dive deeper and ask essential questions to learn more than just the basic facts. So you can see here, there are five questions. And on the first, on the left, you can see the student who wanted to examine more about Jim Thorpe. So I have my students just select three questions. It's a lot. This is a very involved process. So this part of thinking routine takes another class period or two to get through. So I have them pick three questions of the five. And with number one on the left, the student decided to pick the question, what is the story, which is the basic essential facts. And then he went on, what is the human story? And the human story is about, this one is about Jim Thorpe. And it's about more on, the personal story, his relationships, his feelings. And then he wanted to answer the question about what is the untold story about this individual? And he learned more about Jim Thorpe and how Jim Thorpe, his medals were taken away from him and how this was all based in discrimination. Because even though he was Native American, many white athletes who did similar things, their medals were not taken away and the injustice that happened because of that. On the right, I had another student do their unveiling story thinking routine on Maria Tallchief and how she was part of the Osage Nation, how she struggled in her career as a Native American and what that meant for her career and how she had to balance the two. So the students really were able to go deep and using the resources from the learning lab to find out more about these individuals. And on the final day of the activity, if you'd like to move to the next slide, please. They use the unveiling stories thinking routine to create a final product. And the final product in this case was to use the information that they collected to produce a personal analogy, or really a first person narrative as the individual they researched. And they had to incorporate all the information that they found in the unveiling stories routine, as well as to connect it to the idea of Russell Means about how these Native peoples were, these Native individuals were part of a modern society and how they have a rich, complex history. So on the left, one student did a posthumous autobiography of Jim Thorpe, and you can see that he reviewed about his achievements, but also went into the feelings and complexities about what happened when his medals were taken away and the injustice that he endured and the difficulties that he had in his life. And on the right, I had a student who was just enthralled with Zitka Lessa and found that her struggle between identity as Gertrude Simmons and Zitka Lessa and her education just grabbed her attention. And she was really interested in knowing more about how she became an activist and made great changes for her people. So essentially, this was the final product. that students had to create. And it really lent itself well. We just actually started reading the novel, reading the book, Killers of the Flower Moon. And you can see that students really made these connections about how, you know, seeing from this learning lab and reading the book and seeing how individuals likewise in the book are not people who they might have seen in Western or Hollywood movies, but they are real individuals who lived in modern times and had real life experiences with a rich history. So that is one sample of how I use a learning lab and products from the Smithsonian in my teaching. If you go to the next slide, I can tell you how I tend to do a lot of artwork, thinking routines, literature and poetry connections in my classroom. And I really like how I can connect this sometimes with opportunities in other places. So being from Illinois, the Illinois Humanities Council every year has a Gwendolyn Brooks Youth Poetry Awards. And these awards recognize students in grades from kindergarten up to grade 12. And they recognize two winners per grade level. And my school this year was very fortunate in that we had four winners and two honorable mentions from grades four through eight. And four of the entries emanated from Smithsonian artworks and thinking routines. And I can show you just a quick sample of that. So if you go to the next slide. In this case, I had my students read The Book Thief by Marcus Zizek. And in that novel, it's about a young girl living in Nazi Germany during World War II and the narrator's death. Marcus Zizek is a brilliant writer who incorporates a lot of poetry and figurative language and imagery while connecting to ideas of, you know, nature, life, death, the universe, survival. And his writing style he's really inspired a lot by nature and in the sky and looking at, for instance, the motif of the eclipse. So I made that immediate connection to the artwork, The Eclipse by Alma Thomas. And if you didn't get to see the Alma Thomas exhibit presentation an hour or so ago, please go watch it because it was fantastic. Because likewise, Alma Thomas also had these connections to nature, space travel, and the universe. So I had my students do a see, think, wonder on this particular artwork. And then if you go to the next slide, I know I'm running out of time, so I'm getting through it. I had my students then, you know, reflect and look at a learning lab with other pieces by Alma Thomas. And this is a document that I push out through Google Docs to do a poetry draft. You can see that I have elements on the left that we've discussed in class. We look at the author's craft and look in particular at how Marcus Zizek uses poetry language and figurative language in his writing. And I have students connect that with one of the images from Alma Thomas. And they had to incorporate the themes about nature, life, death, survival. And we work and edit in this document. And then we can go to the next slide. And this is the final product. And it was one of the winners for eighth grade. And I'm just gonna read real briefly a quick stanza from it. It's by Amelia, it's called Cross Stitch. Death holds the needle, life is the thread, the pokes, the stars, the embroidery hoop of the sky. Stitching constellations and writing words, tendrils twine and curve and braid into each other, faster, fastened, fastened within ourselves. And if you look through it, the amazing work and the quality of such work really stems from all the resources and strategies that I received and learned from the Smithsonian. The use of artifacts and thinking routines has a profound effect on my teaching and on my students. And I can't thank everyone enough at the Smithsonian for their guidance and support. And thank you for listening for me today. And I'll pass it on to Phoebe.
Thank you so much, Yolanda, for sharing those wonderful examples from your English classroom. We wanted to just share very briefly a few examples of how arts integration or museum object integration can work across the curriculum in some different areas. So these are three examples. I'll share all three in a minute from the past two summers of Smithsonian summer sessions, which were these free 5-day virtual programs for teachers around the country. And this first example is called Learning in the Age of Corona. And this is by Jean Turney, and it was designed for elementary school students, inspired very much by our current moment in the pandemic, and encouraged students to explore what is most essential about learning and using some Smithsonian objects to explore different types of learning contexts. If you'll go ahead one. This other example is called Integration in Education by Elizabeth Moody. This is designed for middle and high school history students to explore school integration, particularly Brown versus Board of Education and the Little Rock Nine. So there are some great primary resources in here for history students. And then if you'll put page one ahead, this final example, we didn't have a lot of science and math teachers participating, but we had some, and this is a great example of sort of STEM integration with arts and cultural history. And it's called Quipu Coded Language, A Mathematical Message from the Incas by Dr. Shakia Bland, and explores the ancient Incan practice of recording data and information on arrangements of knotted strings known as quipu. So these are just three examples, and you can search hashtag summer sessions on the Learning Lab, learninglab.si.edu. To find more. And I'm going to turn it over to Alison to tell us more about summer sessions edX courses.
Perfect. Thank you, Phoebe. So the summer sessions were, as Phoebe mentioned, they were 2 5-week long workshops that we ran. One was just this past summer and one was the summer before. And what we did is after they ran live, we took them and we put them on the edX platform, which is an online learning platform. And Irina's gonna drop the link in the chat to the Smithsonian courses that we have available. Because we wanted to make sure that people who weren't able to come to the summer sessions or who wanted to review any of the thing that we did were able to take these professional development opportunities. So we have 2 sitting up there right now. One is summer sessions from 2020, which is interdisciplinary teaching with museum objects. And this is in this one, we looked at museum educators were exploring connections among their collections and modeling teaching strategies that you could implement in your own classrooms, either online or in person. And then the second is the summer sessions from this year, which is called Interrogating the Stories We Tell. So here, our educators came together and looked at museum objects and works of art and looked at how we could use them to broaden perspectives, reveal silent stories, and make relevant connections to the world today. And again, modeling teaching strategies that you can use either in person or online. So what I wanted to do now really quickly, if you'll advance to the next slide, is I just wanted to walk you through what the experience looks like in the online platform. So you can go ahead and put play on that video, and hopefully this works. And these courses are available, again, they're available for free, but on the edX platform. Just waiting to see if that video starts playing. And if it doesn't, we may have an even shorter session, and that's okay.
It does not.
It does not. Okay. So the learning, thank you so much, Joe. So so with edX, you have the opportunity to go through, and what you'll see is the way that the course is broken up is we have it available for 14 weeks. So intended to, sorry about the dog, intended to take about an hour or an hour and a half of your time each week. And there's for every session, there is a Learning Lab collection connected to the session. And then museum educators guide you through using their objects or their works of art in your classroom with a teaching strategy. And then there's a reflection opportunity for you so that you can think about how you can go ahead and practice using one of those teaching strategies, but then also think about how you might use that in your classroom. So again, Irina has put a link in the chat to those to our edX site where you can enroll in either of these 2 courses. Hopefully you'll enroll in both of these 2 courses. You can take them at your own pace. And again, they are available for free. So I'm gonna turn it back over to Briana. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Alison. I think that we are very quickly getting to the time where we are happy to answer any questions that you all may have for us. I think you can shift to the next slide. questions? Irina, has anything come through in the chat? Any questions for us?
I don't see any specific questions, but there are a lot of great observations about the objects that we saw today, and a lot of congratulations to Yolanda for such an amazing classroom experience that she provided.
Yes, absolutely. I will second that, and I know that Phoebe and Allison will third and fourth it as well. It is always so lovely to see how teachers are actually taking these objects and using them with their students. Because we as museum educators, right, we have ideas of how they should be used or how they could be used. But you know, it's always great to see them in the classroom.
It's all thanks to you and everyone at the Smithsonian. You supported teachers tremendously. So thank you, thank you, thank you.
So we did actually have a question about what's a good way to get started with close looking, and how do you choose an artwork? Ooh, that is such a good question. I'm gonna take a first go, Phoebe. I think that starting with a very simple see, think, wonder is probably the best way to get started with close looking. And how you choose, I think, is based off of what you're teaching. So if you're teaching a particular point in history, my suggestion might be to get on the Smithsonian's Learning Lab site, which is learninglab.si.edu, and type in Civil War, or type in a specific individual, or type in even an idea, and see what comes up. And the more you facilitate these close looking strategies, the more you'll branch out into the very wide variety of strategies that are available, especially with Harvard's Project Zero thinking routines. Phoebe?
I think that's great. I think also look for artworks that have something like a little interesting or weird to them that students will be curious about, because that's always a great way to get started with curiosity and questions. That would be my advice. And we're at the end of our 50 minutes, I think. So we wanted to just share our contact information. Please do reach out to us if you have any follow-up questions. And we just wanted to thank you again for participating today. It was lovely speaking with you all.
Thank you, everyone.